Penguin Random House Audio presents Mother Nature, a 5,000-mile journey to discover if a mother and son can survive their differences. This is the author, Jedidiah Jenkins. To listen to an hour-long conversation between me and my mom about our relationship, search for Question the Self wherever you listen to podcasts. To little Jed, who thought it would all fall apart and he would lose everything, even his mom. This rupture between parents and their children is what happens over and over with every new generation. There is nothing for it, no remedy, no answer. Who is right? They're both right, and they're both wrong, and neither will ever understand the other. Keith Gessen, reviewing Ivan Turgenev's Fathers and Sons for The New Yorker. The road has its own reasons, and no two travelers will have the same understanding of those reasons, if indeed they come to an understanding of them at all. Cormac McCarthy, The Crossing. Chapter 1. Let me begin with a parable. It comes from India, The Blind Monks and the Elephant. It goes like this. There's a group of blind monks living on the edge of town. They've lived in their monastery for many years, passing the time in peace and prayer. Until one day, when a strange new animal is brought to the village. It is called an elephant. Word of its arrival spreads to every house, and crowds form in the town square day and night. The monks decide that they want to go experience this creature. They've never heard of such a thing, and they want to touch it. They hurry to the town square, where they hear the murmurs of a large crowd and a new sound, the grumble of an animal that must be very large. They make their way through the townspeople, and now the monster's groans are very close. The first monk walks up and touches the left tusk, amazed at its size. Another feels the trunk, running his hands along the powerful snaking appendage. Another gently traces his fingers around the giant flapping ear. Another its leg. There are many people surrounding the elephant, touching it where they can. Before long, the monk's time is up. There is a line, of course, and a short man in uniform sends them on their way. The monks walk home stupefied, filled with the wonder of something bigger than their imagination. They are laughing and holding hands. They are electrified, talking fast and over each other. What a wonder! A giant made entirely of bone. Bone? No, it was a leathery winged creature. What are the two of you saying? It's a 10-foot-tall hairy snake. To each monk's dismay, none of their stories align. I know that it was bone. I touched it. And how can you say otherwise? Something about the arguing makes the men double down on their memories, certain not only of their picture of the elephant, but that the others must be delusional. First, they raise their voices. Then they are shouting, "You're a liar! How dare you call me a liar?" And then fists are swinging. In many versions of the story, the community of monks falls apart and they go their separate ways. On January 1st, 2003, I flipped my car. I was home from college, driving to my friend Adam's house on the morning of New Year's Day. You may guess that I was hungover. I was not. I was a good Christian boy who thought drinking was for losers. But I had stayed up late, drinking Martinelli's sparkling cider and playing catchphrase with my Christian friends. When I left my mom's house, it was perhaps 10 a.m., and it had just begun to rain. I heard somewhere that the road is slickest just as the rain begins, because the water lifts the accumulated soot and dirt off the asphalt, making it slippery. I was driving my mom's extra car, a Ford Explorer from the early 90s. The seatbelts didn't latch. The tires were bald, as smooth as marble. But I didn't think of any of that. I was young, and I got in the car with no seatbelts and bald tires because I wanted to hang out with my friends and play Nintendo 64. The drive was only a few miles, but it snaked through the hills south of Nashville, S-curved rivers of pavement connecting neighborhoods hidden in maple, buckeye, and oak. That morning, I was playing Tori Amos's A Sort of Fairy Tale, loud and full in the doomed car. I remember being thrilled when she sang about driving up on the 101, as I finally knew what that was, going to college in Los Angeles. On Granny White Pike, while navigating a curve that is now forever burned into my limbic system, I felt my car detach from the normal rules of physics. My stomach knew before my mind. I was floating, disconnected from the road, and rotating. Adrenaline tingled across my ribcage. The car spun counterclockwise, turning perpendicular to the lane I'd been driving in, at which point the tires found just enough purchase to launch the vehicle off the road. On both sides of the road were steep, upward-sloping hills. My car jammed itself up the incline, crunching bushes like paper lanterns, and then barrel-rolled back down into the ditch. Remember, my seatbelt didn't buckle, so as the vehicle began rolling, I was ripped from the driver's seat, my legs dragging across the gear shift like noodles. My head slammed into the passenger window, breaking it. Then the car rolled again and I was flung to the driver's seat, breaking that window too. I remember the airbag coming out of the glove compartment very slowly, white powder everywhere as if a balloon of flour had popped. Then the car came to a stop in the muddy ditch, passenger window to the ground, and me somehow back on that side, crumpled like spilled spaghetti in my head in the mud. In the strange new stillness, Tori Amos was singing, "I'm so sad, like a good book I can't put this day back. It's a sort of fairy tale." I would have expected her voice to be crackly or distorted, like in a movie crash scene, but she sounded perfect. A win for Ford's stereo department. With my body scrunched in the passenger seat, my mind came back online. Wow, I think I'm okay. Am I in shock? I feel fine. Get up. I pushed a hand into the mud, folded my legs underneath me, and contorted myself upright. As I stood all the way up and popped my head out of the driver's side window, I heard a man's voice yelling, "Don't move! Stay there!" He was walking my way from a station wagon with a woman and three kids inside. "I'm fine, I feel fine," I said. "Okay, well, lie down," he said as he reached me. As I finished crawling out the driver's window, I caught myself in the side view mirror. I had blood all over my face. I guess enough adrenaline was running through me that I didn't feel shock at the sight of it, just disconnected curiosity. I put my hand in my jaw and it felt fine. But then I touched my scalp and felt 100 little bits of glass. When a windshield shatters, it's designed to break into tiny pieces so the shards don't stab us dead. The glass had made its home in my scalp, sending blood down my face like a Carrie reference. I remember thinking, no wonder this man is worried about me. I'm a horror movie. I assured him I was fine, and then I heard the sirens. That was fast, I thought. It may not have been fast, I'm not sure. Danger collapses time into soup. The man and the station wagon disappear from my memory here. I was surprised when a fire truck showed up. Why not an ambulance? But four or five firemen jumped out and ran over to me. They instructed me to lie on my back. "I'm fine," I said. "Okay, let me check you," one of them said. I remember thinking he was tall and his arms were big, the muscles filling his sleeve to remove all creases. He took my foot and began squeezing me every few inches to see if I'd wince or if he could find a broken something. Even in my shock, I noticed how good it felt for this man to touch me, this little massage. Then I thought how pathetic it was to be thinking that, covered in blood next to a flipped, broken car. "Am I Wolverine? Am I invincible?" I joked as the firefighter felt my neck and head. "You must be," he said. He wasn't tender, just thorough, which felt very masculine, which made it more attractive. Just then, my friend Kyle's face appeared over me like a terror-struck angel. I hadn't realized we were sitting right in front of his house. Kyle had been driving home when he saw the overturned car, a car he knew to be mine. No one had ever looked at me with such horror and desperation, and I thought how nice it was that he cared that much about me. "Everything looks fine," the firefighter said. "Do you have someone you can call to come pick you up?" Kyle grabbed my shoulder. "How can I help? Do you want me to take you home?" "Oh, I'm okay," I said. "I'll just call my mom. She'll come get me. She'll love saving the day." Kyle handed me his phone. It was hard to see the numbers. My vision was blurry. I dialed slowly. While the phone rang, I prepared myself to sound normal. I looked around at the scene, the explorer on it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.